actress and a dancer and a performer.
My name is Nataly Zukerman. In 1990, when I was 12, I had an accident in the scouts and I broke a vertebra in my back. At night at the hospital, my mom asked Dr. Ohanani, 1 meter, 90 centimeters, 6'2", if I would dance again. If she walks again, I will be pleased. I broke vertebra L1, that is located around here. It was broken completely and was thrown into the trash. And it was replaced with a bone taken from here, my left pelvis. The vertebra above it, it got twisted and had to be put back in its place. They tied the two vertebra, the new and the old, and put two metal plates on both sides of my spine and left me with a scar. Actually, I had an x-ray a few months ago, and they found out that one of my metal plates is broken. I've been doing for the last 4 years. It's a very long show, it's an hour and 20 minutes, but that was just 15 minutes from that show. And I want to talk to you today about why I did this show. And I did this show when I was only 34. That was about 4 years ago. Only at the age of 34, I realized that I was disabled. I didn't think about it until that moment. I wasn't fully aware of what the terms mean. And it took me a very long time in my life to actually say that I've got a disability and that I need help. And I want to talk to you today about my journey. I want to talk to you today about how I got to this point only at the age of 34. I want to talk to you about my difficulties, and I want to talk to you about my insights, and to actually discuss how only at the age of 34 I managed to own the term disabled, not only as an artist, but also as a human being. So, like any good story, we will start at the beginning. So, I was born in 1978, which is a very, very long time ago, and I'm the eldest daughter out of three, to Nurit and David, and I had a very, very normal childhood. You know, white house, picket fence, had one dog, three cats, and I loved singing and dancing. That was my favorite thing that I wanted to do. You know, my aunt likes to tell that every family occasion, I made everyone, the whole of my family, dance the hokey pokey. And I love dancing. I studied dancing in every possible ballet studio in the area where I grew up. And I wanted to be a ballerina. It was so important to me to be a ballerina that when my dance teacher didn't want to let me learn to dance on white toes like a ballerina, I was so mad at her that my mom had to make amends between the two of us in order for me to go back to school to study it. And I was the most physical girl. I was in the running team of school. I was practicing gymnastics. And I walked the fastest than anyone else. Everyone knew that. Nataly is the walkest fastest in the family, among my friends. And then, as you know, I was injured. And that was it. I couldn't dance again. And it meant that I didn't want to talk about dancing or hear about dancing. I didn't want anything to do with it. I wanted to put that aside completely. Well, I don't know if you know, sometimes fate or destiny crawling back into our life, and that's what happened with dancing. So when I was in hospital, in the bed next to me, there was this dancer. Her name is Tamal Bowell. She's very famous in Israel as a dancer and a choreographer. And she was injured around the same time that I was injured in a car accident. And she remained paralyzed when she's sitting in a wheelchair. And I was very tiny, but I knew she was a dancer and I adored her. But I could see she was struggling. She was really struggling to cope with the fact that she won't be able to dance again. When she was released from the hospital, she continued to make work. And she continued to dance in a wheelchair. And I was like, wow, how is that possible? I couldn't believe it. A few years after I was released from the hospital, I met my old dance teacher. And she told me she just wanted to see Kamal and perform. And I was so excited. I asked her, how was it? How did it work? And she said to me something I would never forget. She said, Kamal should give the dancing for the dancers. The stage is not a place for people who don't dance, who can't dance. And that was it. I believed her. The stage was a place for people that can, and I couldn't. And that meant that my heart was broken. Because I knew I wouldn't be able to do it again. So I didn't want to hear about it or talk about it. When people came and wanted to take me to the ballet, I was like, no, I don't want to go. Please don't talk to me about it. And I was looking for a way to heal. So I asked my mom if she could enroll me to a drama class when I was about 14. I was working with coaches at the time. And I had to do an audition first. So it was an auditorium very similar to this. And I was working with my coaches. There was only one person in the place at the time that was the drama teacher, and she was sitting around there. And I was walking with my crutches, put them aside, went on stage and sat on a chair because I find it difficult to stand for a very long time. And all of the lights were blacked out completely. There was only one light, and it was on stage, and it was on me. And I started my monologue, and the teacher looked at me, and it was love at first sight. I just knew that that's what I wanted to be. Because it was the very first time that I enjoyed someone watching me. You know, when I was 14 and I was walking with crutches, everyone kept looking at me all the time, and I hated it. I didn't want people to look at me with the right crutches. You know, and I had people all the time looking at me, like doctors examining me on a weekly basis. I had physiotherapists touch me almost every day. I had private investigators following me on behalf of the Social Security Office and on behalf of different insurance companies, because we were suing the scouts and they wanted to show that I don't have a disability. So when I went home, I had to close the windows and the curtains all the time. Because God forbid they'll see me that I do something and find out that it's like too much and I won't get, you know, the money that I needed to be better. And I had kids in school pointing at me, also people down the streets. So I couldn't control that look, and I didn't want everyone to look at me. That was the stage. I couldn't control it. I decide what you see and how you see me. And that was really empowering. Because outside, because everyone looked at me and I wanted to disappear, you know what I did? I just went like that all the time. I didn't just say, if I look like this, if I don't look at you, you will not see me. Which obviously wasn't true. But that's how it felt. So most of my childhood years, I just walked like that, with huge sunglasses on, so no one will ever be able to see me. But the stage was different, and I could control how people look at me. When I was 16, and the doctor said to me that I can put my crutches aside and I don't have to walk with them, that's what I did. And I loved it. I love the fact that no one knew about disability. No one knew that I meant me. No one knew that I had problems. And I was fine. In school, though, people knew about my disability and they were very supportive. For example, I had a special car driver with me every day to school. And due to my back pains at the time, they were quite a lot. I didn't go to school a lot, and it was all approved by my teacher in advance. And because I couldn't run, I was exempt from sports lessons, which was great. And I was exempt also from high school trips. I didn't go to any of the high school trips because they were very physical. So at the time, it felt that I was amazing because the reading was accommodating to my needs. And, you know, I kept saying, I can't do it. And everyone said, yeah, that's fine. If you can't, that's absolutely fine. But let's look at it from a different point of view. It actually meant that instead of study, I didn't do almost anything. Everyone in Israel at school, there are so many social activities, and I just didn't take part in any of them. I was excluded from almost everything. Now, I'm a teacher now, and I can't help it. Wasn't it the easiest way out? Could they not, like, change the curriculum in order for me to take part? For example, I know I can't run, but sports is like a huge subject. You know, I can do Pilates really well or yoga. Why not use that as part of the curriculum so I'll be able to take part? Or maybe high school trips. We don't need to go hiking or traveling. We can go to a museum. I'm really good at walking in the museum. You know, I could have taken part, but no one fights for me. And everyone was like, yes, of course, if you can, that's absolutely fine. Just stay aside. So both me and the teachers at the school, we all decided it's so much better if I stay at home. And that's the way I was until I was about 18. When I graduated at the age of 18, I don't know if you know, but in Israel, everyone goes to the army, boys and girls. Again, I was excluded and I told them that I won't be able to be drafted. I was like, that's fine, I don't want to go to the army, if they don't want me, I'll go and study acting. So much better. But, again, it didn't really go that smoothly. I phoned one of the acting schools in Israel, and they asked why I didn't go to the army, so I told them, my name is Nataly Zukerman, in 1990 when I was 12, had an accident, the whole story again. Can you do movement classes? And I was like, I don't think I can. Then I'm so sorry, but we won't even be able to audition. I was like, okay, yeah, that's fair enough. You know, an actor, he needs to be very physical, and he needs to be versatile. An actor needs to be able to embody different characters, different characteristics, and my video will always live, obviously. And you know, there's something called typecast. So how many limiting characters in the theater we have? I know about 3, and 2 of them are men. So it makes sense that I would be able to act those characters. So, you know. And also, on the Israeli theater scene, I never seen any disabled actors, ever. Maybe once. And maybe, you know, that was 20 years ago, but even today it's still the same. We don't have those kind of actors on stage. We don't have disabled actors on stage. And even more than that, I read an interview with this girl. She's an emerging disabled actress, and she talked in one of the newspapers about her ordeal to get into the acting schools. And she told in the article that about 5 years ago, when she tried to get into all the acting schools, she did go to an audition, but everyone said, no, you can't. Until the last audition, she decided to do an experiment. And you know what she did? She lied. She said that she twisted her ankle, and that's what she's limping. And guess what? She got it. 2 weeks later, when they realized that twisted ankle isn't going away, and she continued to limp, she was called to the head of the acting school, and she was told she's on probation. Not because she lied. She was on probation because they said, well, you know, we're not really sure there is a place for a disabled performer in the Israeli stage, so why are you still here? But she continued to be there, and now she's an actress in films. So I kind of got the message. The message was, if you want to stay in the theater, you have to be behind the scenes. You can't be in front of the scene. You can't be on stage. And I was, that's fine. And I went to study directing. And for 3 years of directing, I didn't take any part in any of the movement classes or stage combat or whatever. But something changed in my last year. In the last year, we were asked to make a theatrical event in which we performed with the class ourselves. And I was like, what can I tell my classmates that they don't know already about me because we've been together for 3 years? And you know, I decided I'm not going to make up a character, I'm going to be myself. And I'm going to perform different actions that they never saw me do before. So, I decided to dance. And I invited people from the audience to come and dance with me on stage. And then I showed them my back and asked people to calibrate my scar. And I heard everyone very quiet and crying. And at the end of it, they all shouted and like laughed really loud. And I was, wow, I'm actually good. I'm interesting. My body is interesting. I've got a story to tell. No one can shiver like me. No one can do the same things that I can do. And my teachers all of a sudden find beauty in it. So when I had to choreograph a dance, and I did it with a chair, I love sitting on a chair, it's so much human here. I remember the look on my teacher's face. He was so happy. And he was so proud of me. Because it was good. And I realized I need to make more work. And I need to stop being behind the scenes and I need to be in front of the stage. And at that time, I also realized that I never thought of myself as having a disability. I was the girl with the limp, and that was up, and that was it. And when I moved back to Israel and I started talking to people to say to them, you know, I'm disabled, they were like, no, you're not. And I had that so many times since. Because they were really scared of it. And I was like, why are you so scared of people who have got disabilities? Why are you so scared? And I went up a little research, and I found this in a book. And they said there that the world is divided into two groups of people. Those who are disabled now, and those who will be disabled in the future. Which means that we are all the disability spectrum. Everyone. And that's why you're so scared of it a lot of the time. So I wanted to make work about my disability, and I wanted to make work on stage. And I was trying to think to myself, where does my disability really perform itself? And I realized that at home, I don't feel disabled at all. But when I'm outside, I really feel disabled, and that is because of the staircase. I hate staircases. Because I find it really difficult to walk up and down the stairs. For some people it might be easy, but for me it's really difficult. And I realize that the staircase is a barrier fence between those who can and those who can't. So, for example, I went to the aquarium the other day in Boston. And the aquarium is built like a spiral. So everyone can go up together. Women with trolleys, men with trolleys, people in a wheelchair, people without wheelchair, everyone goes together. We don't need to separate. Those are for the stairs, those are for the elevators, that's always located right to the back. So I was looking for the busiest staircase ever, because I wanted to start walking that staircase. And I put a beautiful evening black dress, and I was barefoot like a man. And I decided I want to walk up, just like an able person do. Which meant that from a 5-minute action, that became a 3-hour piece. Because every time I didn't do it correctly, I had to do again the same step. And I was invited to perform it in a disability art festival in Jerusalem Cinematheque, which is a very beautiful building, and in the middle of it, there is a huge staircase. Yeah, so I put my beautiful dress on, and people were going up and down together with me, but I was much slower than everyone else. So I kind of became the element that interfered in the flow of the crowd. And people start shouting at me, "Move away!" Now, I just want to remind you, there's a disability art festival. And the other people were much nicer, and they said, do you want a hand, or maybe you should take the lift? Everyone has something to say. And some people just looked at me like, what is she doing? Because again, I don't look disabled, especially not with my black beautiful dress. And from the corner of my eye, I could see this guy who was standing at the side, and he was with his crutches. And he kept looking at me for about 3 hours. And at the end of it, he came to me and said, "You know, what you've been through now for 3 hours, that's the story of my life. I have cerebral palsy, and that's my everyday life. Every day, those people shouting at me, get out, people ask me if I need help, people ask me to take the lift, but I just want to take the stairs. Because that's what I want, and even if it takes a long time." You know, it was the very first time that someone said to me that me and him are part of the same community. We've shared the same experience, we share the same feeling. And I realized I have a community. I'm part of a community. And I need to stop hiding, and I need to talk about my disability, and I need to put that in center stage. And that happened around the age of 34, and that's why at that point I decided to make a show about it. And to place a sign over my head saying that I've got a disability. You know, maybe today there are still not enough characters for disabled people. But we must be on stage. We must show other bodies on stage. Whatever you interpret the idea of another body, we must show ourselves. We should never disappear. We should stay here and say that we're not going away.